This bit of technology has absolutely exploded into our lives. 10 years ago, they barely existed. Now, they're everywhere. Science is scrabbling to keep up, and the experts are bitterly divided.
Are we on the brink of a health revolution, or gambling our way into a catastrophe?
Now, I'm about to do something that many years ago I swore I would never do. It's dangerous, it's addictive, it's disgusting, and there's a good chance that I'm going to be sick, which is why I've got a bucket down there. Ah, God, people do this for pleasure.
But I have never, ever smoked before. Not even a drag.
It's not, I think, what happens in the movies. I don't feel remotely nauseous. I just feel quite buzzy at the moment. So I get it. I think I finally get why people smoke. Now we've got the electronic or e-cigarette. It's being marketed as a much less harmful way of getting your nicotine hit. But is it the greatest public health measure ever invented, as some people claim, or simply another way of keeping us addicted to nicotine with dangerous, unforeseen consequences?
To discover what they do to a healthy non-smoker, I'm going to test them on myself. So I've asked psychologist and addiction expert, Dr. Lynn Dawkins, to create a vaping schedule for me to follow.
If you want to reflect what a regular vapor would do, you're looking at fairly continuous puffing throughout the day.
I'm having a very different experience. As a non-smoker who's taken up vaping for a month to see how it affects me, I'm struggling to stick to my schedule. I'm not experiencing cravings, but I am experiencing inconvenience. Vaping several times an hour is tricky when you work on the seventh floor of a building that doesn't allow it. There have been recent reports claiming that some of the chemicals used to give e-liquids their flavours are potentially toxic. So, should vapers be worried?
Many flavorings are in the cosmetics and in the food, and they were tested. And we know that they are safe when we eat them, when we apply them on the skin. However, now we need to make sure that they are also safe when we inhale them.
Mache then compares the number of cells that survive being exposed to the two different flavors, menthol and pina colada. Surprisingly enough, in this experiment, the fresh menthol flavoring killed many more cells than the sweet pina colada.
We need to get this data as soon as possible to inform users and regulators about different flavorings and their effect on our lungs.
But how does that compare to tobacco smoke?
Oh, this is really, really toxic. Only 6% of the cells survive exposure to tobacco smoke. There is a huge difference between electronic cigarettes and tobacco cigarettes.
The evidence we do have at the moment suggests that passive vaping is nothing like as bad for you as passive smoking.
I've been puffing away conscientiously for 4 weeks. So what has it been doing to me?
To find out, I'm catching up with Dr. Lynn Dawkins. Lynn is putting me through a variety of cognitive tests.
Your reaction time today after using your e-cigarette was fairly consistently slower than when we tested you at baseline.
I've improved in a couple of tests, but in others, I've got worse. My results aren't consistent with what Lynn has found in smokers. A few weeks of inhaling nicotine hasn't made me any smarter or quicker.
There is some emerging evidence that in certain conditions, such as Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, that nicotine may have a cognitive enhancing effect.
Research in animals suggests that nicotine is more addictive when it's delivered in combination with other chemicals found in regular cigarettes. So it may be that vaping is simply less addictive than smoking. Worldwide, there are currently around 1 billion smokers. and about half of them will be killed by their habit. If e-cigarettes can win a significant share of the $1 trillion tobacco market, this could transform the world's health.